Thank you very much for coming to this session on trade and economic transformation, which I think is the session with the shortest title today. I hope we'll have a good debate. My name is Dirk de Velde from the Overseas Development Institute, and one of the things that I'm doing is running a program called Supporting Economic Transformation, which is co-hosting this this event. And this program has started as a response to what many of you and many people have observed, in particularly in African countries, is that there is high growth in a range of countries in over the last 10 to 15 years, but its growth hasn't accompanied with by diversification, increased industrialization, and it's there's still concentrated export baskets around. And I think that's very important to observe, because you then don't have the economic transformation that is needed for high quality growth to sustain. This debate today now is on trade and economic transformation, and the work that we've been doing so far highlights two big issues. One is that ideas matter, and the other is that implementation matters. In terms of ideas matter, is that when you look at those countries that have transformed, have successfully and have been able to raise productivity over a sustained period of time, have done so by emphasizing competitiveness. And it isn't possible to rely on the market, domestic market alone, no matter how big you are as an economy. And that's an important lesson. And that's not always observed in when you think about policymakers around countries that are trying to industrialize, that are trying to transform economically, that they might think, well, let's first build up a manufacturing capabilities behind protected borders. And I think the lessons will tell you that that's not really feasible. At the same time, also ideas matter when it comes to trade and services, trade and goods, and we will talk a lot about trade and services today. But there has been many countries, if you look around in low-income countries, there is an emphasis on trade in goods, much less so on trade in services. And if there is an emphasis on trade and services, then it's completely the other way around and say, well, let's export trade and services without thinking about linkages with the goods sector, agriculture or manufacturing. And that's an important issue also to highlight. Now, the other issue that we've been highlighting in our program work so far is that implementation matters. And implementation matters in the sense that if you look at countries that have transformed successfully and have used trade, they've done so by combining a range of policies, whether it's education policies, skills policies, infrastructure, trade facilitation, export competitiveness. They've done a range of things. And that's a tall order to get it all right at the same time. And there, if you look at some countries that are beginning to transform, if you think about Bangladesh, sometimes one change may make a difference. One company that has learned particular skills and have set up a factory in Bangladesh has then had lots of spillover effects. And you start small, and that's maybe something that is a different way of looking at it. It's not that you do all things at the same time, but just start small, and when it works, scale it up, and that has spillover effects, and then you can actually show that things work. Okay, that's a sort of two-minute introduction to our program, and we've got a lot that we've distributed on our website. But we're here, of course, to discuss these issues with a stellar panel. We've got a number of speakers, and we'll start with Chris Barton, who is the Director of International Trade Policy in the UK government, so a very senior civil service officer. And he'll give his introduction on why trade and economic transformation is so important from his perspective. We'll then move on to my colleague, Max Mendes-Parra, who is leading our work on trade at the Overseas Development Institute. And he'll focus particularly on trade and services and economic transformation. And then we'll have a presentation or a comment by Bernard Hoekman, who is a professor and director of global economics at the Robert Schuman Center for Advanced Studies at the European University Institute. And then we'll go to Arantxa Gonzalez, who who is the Chief Executive Officer, Executive Director of the ITC, and very good campaigner on aid for trade in the past, but also have worked a lot on trade in services. So we're looking forward to hearing from her as well. And then there are some discussions by Frank Matsart, who's the Chief Executive Officer here in Nairobi of the Trademark East Africa Program. Very good. I've set the panel three key points to discuss, and they're in the program. So how have countries been successful in using trade for economic transformation? What is the role of services trade in the process of economic transformation, and what are now the implications for trade policy? So I hope we, at the end of the day, the end of the session, we'll get a bit closer to this. And it is big picture stuff, because I think it is important to highlight those as well. Very good. Let's start with Chris Barton. Over to you. You've got about 5 to 7 minutes.
Hello. Well, welcome everybody, and it's a real pleasure to be here. So as described, my name is Chris Barton. I'm Director of International Trade Policy in the UK government. And we just say, as an explanation of that, that that includes both a business department focus on trade, but also a development, DFID, International Development Department. And we have a joint unit with both those departments within it, as well actually now as our Foreign Office as well, because we see these issues as so very much interlinked. And I just would like to make sort of five brief points to set the scene a bit for this discussion, five propositions. And then I have to confess, with many apologies, I then have to leave at 11:45. So the plus side is, if you completely disagree with my propositions, you can tear them to shreds and I'll be out of the room and I won't cry. So first proposition I would make is that trade is the single most powerful mechanism we have to reduce poverty. At the moment, trade is the single most powerful mechanism we have to reduce poverty and promote development. And if you want any example of whether that is true or not, I think Korea gives a fantastic example. North Korea, South Korea. One country which, after the problems of the 1950s, opened up, embraced trade, embraced economic reform, and has grown enormously. And now one of the G20 members. Another part of Korea, which decided to close its borders, to be inward-looking, and is now one of the most poorest and repressive regimes in the country, in the world. So I think that is one of the most powerful examples of where opening up, promoting free trade, embracing the market, really delivers enormous benefits, and the opposite is deeply damaging it. And I think that's really important that we make that message clear. Because I think it's one of the real tragedies sometimes in the trade debate and the development debate, that sometimes some of those who purport to be speaking most for the interests of the poorest in society make out that trade is somehow the enemy, there's something suspicious about trade, it's something that's being done by rich countries against poor countries, and I think that is profoundly mistaken. So first proposition, that trade is the most powerful mechanism we have for promoting development. A second proposition that relates to that is that trade is can be the ultimate win-win, i.e. both sides in any trade deal or any individual item of trade benefit from it. And I think that, again, is really important, particularly in some of the debate that we see in the context of the WTO, that it's sometimes made out that trade is, for it to work, it's about rich countries sort of hurting themselves by opening their markets, and poor countries then protecting themselves by not taking on mechanisms to open up trade. And I think that is a fundamentally misconceived approach to trade. First of all, that richer countries opening up their markets to greater trade, including from developing and less developed countries, you know, who benefits most from that is the developed countries themselves. That is a win. You benefit from greater competition, greater choice, and so forth. But similarly, taking commitments to open up markets from developing and least developed countries, again, that is a benefit and a good thing, and something that which helps developing and least developed countries. It isn't something terrible that needs to be protected from. It's one of the most powerful, I also think one of the most misunderstood bits of economic theory of comparative advantage, that everyone, every country can benefit from trade, whatever its resource base, whatever its stage of economic development, by opening up to international trade. Third proposition is that the Doha Development Agenda, that what we've agreed to date and what hopefully we are agreeing this week, is a very powerful pro-development deal. I think, again, there's plenty of people out there who like to criticize the WTO, criticize the Doha Development Agenda, say we failed to deliver. Actually, I think that's just simply not true. I think, first of all, back to Bali, the trade facilitation agreement delivering about 50% of the potential benefits of the Doha Development Agenda, as long as we get on with fully ratifying and implementing it, has the potential to be really transformational in reducing barriers to trade and sometimes very practical ways at the border. And the disproportionate benefits from the trade facilitation agreement for developing countries. But we all gain, we estimate, I think all economic estimates have to be taken with a pinch of salt, but we estimate that it could be worth about $100 billion to the UK economy, and about $10 billion of that focused in Africa. So that's a huge benefit. And if we get the agreement on the things that we're looking for this week, okay, it's not, I don't think any of us can pretend it's the full envisaged DDA package, but it would benefit in two key ways, I think, for developing countries. One is the expressly development focus about reducing some of the barriers to exports from developing countries through mechanisms like duty-free, quota-free. But then also the agricultural element has a really important development focus, because it's about reducing unfair competition, international competition, for domestic markets in other countries. So I think both the agricultural and the quote-unquote development parts of what we're trying to agree in the WTO framework this week have really powerful development benefits. So we should celebrate what we can achieve, assuming we can achieve something this week. I would just say in parenthesis, I think we should all be jumping for joy over the IT agreement, which was reached last night, guaranteeing that no taxes on 10% of global trade, £1.3 trillion worth of trade. I think that's a massive achievement, and again, the benefit for us all, not just a developed country bit. A fourth proposition, that there's more that we need to do in trade liberalisation than trade liberalisation to promote development. So much as I'm a great advocate for opening up markets and greater trade, I think we have to recognise that it is a necessary but not a sufficient factor in allowing development of countries. So absolutely we should be reducing barriers to trade, but we need more, and I think we need more just in two ways, and then I'll wind up at this point. One is aid for trade, which is something the UK government believes very strongly in. We give about £1 billion pounds a year in aid for trade. So that is helping developing and least developed countries to benefit from the benefit from trade. That includes on the negotiating side. So, for example, we've funded a number of people from different developing countries to be here during this week to make sure they can participate in the negotiations effectively. It also includes really practical help on the ground, including, for example, on the trade facilitation side to enable people to implement these deals. And I know colleagues in the panel can say more of that. But also, as well as what we do on the trade side, to see real economic growth, we also need to have the stable regulatory environment, domestic trade by having opening up markets domestically, investment, education, and so forth. So trade is a wonderful and powerful mechanism. We should celebrate it, we should promote it, but we also need to recognize that it is part of a broader package. So there, sorry, I think I ended up with four propositions, which is a good thing. Four propositions for you to agree or disagree with. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much for these very good proposition that we no doubt will be discussing, and that what has been agreed at Bali has the potential to be very transformational if it's, even when it's implemented. Very good. So let's now move to Max for his presentation on trade and economic transformation.
Thank you very much. A pleasure. Can you listen? Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here. My presentation will deal mostly on trade in services and economic transformation. So basically, I will go through first through what we mean with economic transformation, how trade affects economic transformation, how trade in services is expecting to be affecting economic transformation. And then I will present some results of some work that we are doing. It's still work in progress. This is one of the favorite phrases of economists. This is work in progress. And then we'll try to summarize some points. What we mean with economic transformation is basically try to understand what are the determinants of growth and productivity at each level. The micro, at the sector, and the macro level. And basically, this implies to understand how resources are moving from low or to into higher value uses, in particular, how the role of diversification of production, of trade and production play in this process. And basically, economic transformation could be defined as moving resources factors of production mainly from lower into higher productivity activities. And this happens basically through two mechanisms. The first is moving resources between sectors, basically from, let's say, agriculture into manufacturing. This is called typically structural change. And then improving productivity within sectors by refunctionalizing the activities that are produced, for example, within a value chain. Typical example we can think is moving from subsistence agriculture into high crop or commercial agriculture. More a bit on these two mechanisms, let me say basically starting off the premise that in poor countries, LDCs, it is found that the agricultural sector tend to have lower productivity with respect to the developed countries, basically to the best practices. And they tend to employ a lot of people. So we have a lot of workers locked in a low productivity sector. The labor productivity in the manufacturing and in the services sector tend to be lower than, of course, the best international practices, but the gap is smaller. And also offers the possibility, these sectors of increasing, particularly manufacturing, increasing productivity. What we had found, basically, another evidence is that the structural change channel tend to be very important. It's the one that tends to dominate. Another thing that we have found is that actually we cannot classify that all firms as low productivity in LDCs. There are basically a lot of heterogeneity within LDCs countries with very firms that are high productive firms with firms that are low productivity, while in developed countries that dispersion tend to be lower. As I said, the within factor, within productivity change implies the reallocation of resources within the sector, and this implies basically the exit of low productivity firms, the entry of new higher productivity firms, basically that the current firms also improve their productivity. So basically, we think that these channels, these basically, these mechanisms can be triggered by trade. Because basically, in developing countries, in LDCs, and sometimes in many developed countries, the domestic markets are not big enough to provide the require diversification in the demand that this transformation process requires. At the same time, the market size doesn't provide enough competition that motivates firms to be efficient and more cost effective. Therefore, trade and economic transformation are clearly linked. Trade provides opportunity for diversification in production. Trade helps to discovery and development of new productivity capabilities, and it helps to create higher domestic value added in that trade. At the same time, there is a simultaneity in the relationship between economic transformation and trade, because if economic transformation has been succeed, I mean, as it has happened, we will observe that a more diverse production and trade structure and higher domestic value added in output of trade. So basically, there is a sort of circular relationship between trade and economic transformation that works in both directions. And basically, the global competitiveness is important, and we strong the fact of market size as an important determinant for discipline and competitive effects. Let's talk about a bit of services and why is what we have found on services, particularly in LDCs. The share of services has grown in the output and employment in all countries around the world, mostly all of them. In Southeast Asia, for example, this can be seen as a sort of a reversion of a previous industrialization process, where basically that reversion doesn't imply that they're going de-transform. Actually, they are stepping up into higher stages in the value chain. Whilst in Africa, this has been a movement from agriculture into traditional type of services. And this is important here to make two distinctions in the case of services. I would like to make the distinction between modern and traditional services. Modern services are very important in terms of the growth in productivity, but they tend to employ more skilled workers, and basically it's easier basically for middle-income countries to step in this type of services. And here we're talking about financial services, business services, those kind of services, very important in the value chain. Then we have the traditional services that are mostly, but probably I would say something about that, non-tradable with marginal productivity growth. And they tend to employ a lot of unskilled workers. And this is the type of growth in services we are seeing in Africa. And this triggers basically a sort of pessimistic view of the role of services in economic transformation, basically because it implies the movement of low productivity activities into agricultural sector, into low productivity activities in the services sector. So there is no gain in terms of productivity. And services tend to be mostly non-tradable. This is basically a sort of pessimistic view about the roles of services. We have found, and there is some evidence that suggests that services present is an important contribution to the productivity growth in LDCs, that exports in services for many LDCs haven't grown faster than the exports of goods, and services value added is increasingly being embedded in the export, not only of services, but on other goods. So I think that we add this dimension in terms of value added trade. However, one thing that is important is that services remain a very protective sector. It's basically, it's a sector that frequently is more protective than agriculture, for example. And clearly in the region, for example, the case of financial services, particularly those associated with mobile services, although there have been some advances in the region, I mean, still there's a lot to gain there. The potential is very big. And also, for example, services provided under Move Forward is very restricted. I mean, one number is, for example, in the US, 0.5% of the imports of services are just Move Forward. So now I will present some numbers that we have found. First is how services is explaining the change in productivity. We decompose the growth in productivity between 1991 and 2013 coming from services and other sectors. And we can see that in many developing countries, services is the blue one, the blue bar, is actually a major contributor of the growth of labor productivity. So we can say that there is a role for services in productivity growth. The other chart that I would like to show is that export of services, as I said before, has grown faster than the export of goods. And this is something that is evidence from the moment that you know that the share of exports of services in total trade has gone up. But the important point is that the dots in orange are LDCs. We can see that in many LDCs, that growth has been particularly faster. So all the countries that are under the 45-degree line have been countries where trading services has grown very fast. At the same time, I want to say something about the structure of the services exports in LDCs. This chart shows basically how the type of services has changed between 1992 and 2012, defining in different types of services. And what we have found is that basically some traditional services, where I include transport there, not only has grown, but also that are very important in the exports of LDCs. So one of the things is that there are some traditional services that are tradable and that LDCs can step into it to motivate their transformation process. Basically, in that chart, basically what we're seeing is that traditional sectors such as hotels and restaurants associated with probably the tourism has basically increased over the period. And also still, although, I mean, maintenance and repair is reducing their importance, it's basically important. Still, it's important the role of financial intermediation and business services in LDCs has grown during the period. However, when we compare this, I'm not presenting that well, for example, the rest of the world, we see that while in LDCs, this is 30% of the exports of LDCs, in the rest of the world, this is above 50%. The other thing is that this is a very rough chart that basically tried to show how growth in exports of services and goods adjust in terms to the growth in productivity. So on the basically what we can see is that services export growth in export services has been mostly associated with growth in productivity. So there is a clear connection, still a link to define a causality, but it's clear there is a clear connection between the growth of the exports of services and the growth in productivity. The other point I want to make, and now I am starting to enter into more the value chain story, is that services exported from developing countries are becoming intermediate services. So basically what we have used is the EORA MRO input output table to identify where are the services of the LDCs or developing countries being used. Are being used by households or are being used by other firms in other countries? And basically, this chart basically compares what was the share of the exports of intermediate services in 1992 with respect to the share of the intermediate services in 2012. And we can see that almost all countries has increased their exports of intermediates, of intermediate services. This may be still to define whether this is explained because these countries are becoming more productive in the provision of this type of services and that are being used in the value chain, or this is because services in general have become a more intermediate type of good or services. So for example, when we think about tourism, the image that we have is a tourist paying the cost of a hotel at destination, when in fact, basically, probably he contracted a package in his country of origin, and basically the service provided the hotel in Kenya is basically selling the service to this retail in the UK, for example. So that is probably something that is interesting to analyze. Then I want to now enter into what would be the comparison between the exports of value added generated from the services sector with respect to the exports of services. So basically, this is the ratio between your exports of value added of services embedded in your exports of all goods and your export of services. And basically, we have found that for many countries, it's very important the value added or the services exported through the rest of the world via their export in other goods. So I think that this is an additional dimension that we need to add into the trading services. Not only consider the exports of services, but also consider how the services are being used by goods, by, let's say, the natural resources exports in the country, other services as well in their exports. So to summarize, we have basically gone through the importance of the productivity growth in economic transformation, and basically that countries can increase their productivity by jump into higher productivity activities or by increasing the productivity within their activities. Manufacturing is generally regarded as the most transformative sector. There is a lot of literature in the last 50 years. I mean, I come from Latin America, so I know that story. I mean, from that time I studied that. So it's important that. But however, I mean, I think it's not a clear cut that all every manufacturing sector would be good for economic transformation. Although traditional services generally tend to provide weaker links in terms of economic transformation, I think that there are some evidence that indicates that they are traded, that they could be traded by developing countries. They might have important productivity effects. And I believe that the potential of services in economic transformation is particularly stronger when we look at under the light of trading value added. When we check, this is a discussion that was in a panel the other day, when we looked through that, the value added trade. Finally, I think that services is still very protected, so that is probably the negative note and basically the problem, the challenge associated with using services, trading services as a development vehicle, where in general there is in LDCs we see a lot of is limiting the provision of services to mode 2, that is in general what we see is in terms of service of tourism. I think there are needed more preferences for LDCs, and I think that they should be suited to the LDC capabilities. I look to the Australian schedule of preferences on services, and they are offering ramp services for airlines under mode 3 for LDCs. I think that our LDCs are not still in position of providing that kind of services, but there will be other type of services where actually they can have. I think that there should be more scope for inclusion of services in trade agreements. And the final note is that I focus most on the exports of services, but I think that it's very important also that LDCs liberalize the trade of services as well, because the productivity effects on their economic structure depends as well on the how productive how they use services. This is something that in the other the day before, I think Bernard Hoogman was stressing his analysis, how the effect of the use of services in the productivity of other sectors. So thank you very much for your attention.
Well, thank you very much, Max, for that elaborate presentation. So you started out saying there is this pessimistic view of services and the role of services in economic transformation, but then you also presented a range of different types of data analyses that suggested that actually when you look at it from that perspective, we can be more positive about the role of services in economic transformation and particularly role of trade and services. And as long as you take into account the way services trade and manufacturing and agriculture are linked, and that they're not seen as in isolation, I suppose that will link in quite nicely to the next set of comments from Bernard Hoogman. Over to you.
Thank you. Okay, so let me start with where Max also started. Is this on? Yeah. in terms of, you know, what is economic transformation? And essentially, it's all about moving resources out of low productivity activities into higher productivity activities. And that's very different from the way this often gets posed, both even in research, but often in the policy context, that it's all about increasing the manufacturing share of GDP, and it's all about industrialization, and implicitly the notion that people have in their heads, it's all about getting more factories in a country. And I think that really is a misperception. It's a wrong view of the world, and I would even argue that this notion of modern versus traditional services that Max was talking about is, again, not a particularly helpful way of thinking about the role of services in this process of economic transformation. So if you move people out of agriculture and into services, those services activities in the traditional sector, within inverted quotes, is still going to be positive because agricultural productivity is going to increase. So I think you need to think about this not just only in terms of productivity, but also in terms of employment. And clearly, services offer an opportunity to actually do a lot in the way of creating employment, even if it is relatively low productivity. So I think that's something to keep in the back of our minds. But ultimately, this is very much about moving from low productivity into high productivity, low value added into higher value added types of economic production. And that spans a whole slew of things, right? From information technology, the digital economy, e-commerce, but also in agriculture, right? In terms of moving up the value chain in agriculture, there's a huge scope, I think, for increasing productivity. So manufacturing is just one aspect of this. It's an important aspect, but that's what I wanted to make that my first point. Now, trade and services can occur both through direct means, right? So we're selling tourism services to consumers who are coming from another country, and it can occur through indirect means. So essentially, services as an input into production. And I think much of what Max was talking about, and I think much of the focus of the project, as I understand it, is really focusing on the role of direct exports of services as one kind of element of moving into higher value added types of activities. But I would argue the indirect dimension is as, if not more important from a productivity perspective, simply because most firms, no matter what sector they're in, are going to rely very heavily on services in terms of producing whatever it is they're producing, whether it's a good, whether it's a service, whether it's all about agro-processing. So the costs of those services, the efficiency with which those services are produced, the quality of the services, the variety of choice that firms have with respect to the services inputs they need, and the more they can actually rely on outsourcing the things they're not particularly good at, because many firms, of course, if there is a bad services environment, have to produce those things in-house, and that is not necessarily the area in which they have a competitive advantage. So all of those things matter very importantly for productivity of the economy as a whole. And we know, of course, that in order to export, you need to be more productive. So higher productivity firms tend to export more. So therefore, there is a relationship between the efficiency of the service sector and the ability of a country to actually export, whether, again, it's goods or services. That doesn't really matter too much in my thinking. So let me, in just 2 minutes, and apologies for those of you who are in the International Growth Center panel that I was on, where I presented some work that I've done for them with Ben Shepherd on the relationship between services productivity and the manufacturing sector, both the productivity of manufacturing, but also the export performance of manufacturing. And there's a very robust relationship that comes out of, no matter what data source we use, whether we use firm-level data, whether we use trade data, between services productivity and the performance of manufacturing, and more generally, export performance of merchandise, right? So in that sense, it's very clear that there's reasonably robust evidence that this matters. I think the evidence is statistically robust, but I think there is a lot of data problems associated with actually measuring services and the use of services. So I think the results we're getting out of this type of analysis actually underemphasizes the importance of services, simply because services aren't really captured very well in the firm-level surveys and the firm-level data that we have. So I think that's one area where a lot more work needs to be done. There's also, and I agree very much with Max, there's a very strong relationship between barriers to trade and services and productivity performance. And there again, the research evidence shows the higher your barriers to trade and services, the less productive your services sector is, and therefore the more costly those services are going to be for firms that use the services, and therefore that adversely affects your export performance. And here, what comes out of the research is that the channel for this is very much through foreign direct investment, right? So very high barriers to services. They tend to impact the most on foreign direct investment and investors. And if you think about where the technology is going to come from, the know-how is going to come from in terms of how you do things more efficiently, essentially kind of one of the determinants of this productivity improvement, it is through that particular channel. One final point on that is there's also what the research suggests is that this relationship between high barriers to trade in services and the adverse consequences of that for productivity of services and how that feeds through into the economy is very much conditional on the business climate, on the investment climate. And what we find in empirical work that tries to assess what the impact of services trade restrictions are, those tend to be the lowest in countries with the worst economic governance, right? So if you have very high barriers to trade in services and you have a very bad investment climate, you can lower those barriers to trade in services and you're not going to get the response you expect simply because of this investment channel, that's really a key determinant for them to actually enter into a market. Now, the opposite conclusion then also applies. If you have relatively good economic governance and you have high barriers to trade and services, those are the countries that are likely to get the biggest positive effect of lowering those barriers, right? So if we think about the countries in this region, Rwanda, which has done a lot of work in terms of improving economic governance and still has relatively high barriers to some services trade, you know, that is a country that you would expect to see getting more benefits out of reducing that protection than another country. But this link between trade policy and the investment climate, I think, is an important one to keep in mind. More generally, a lot of the countries in this region, and again, it's something Max also said, they have very high barriers to the trade in services that actually matter the most in terms of the cost structure for firms. So think about air transportation, think about professional services, think about barriers to road trucking. Those are the types of services that have a big impact on overall trade costs. So if you can actually reduce the effect that those restrictions on competition have on the cost of those services, that would really give you a big boost potentially for better export performance, and therefore this whole process of economic transformation of getting into other sectors. Now, the big challenge, and let me end with this, where we really don't have enough information, I think where this type of research project that ODI is doing could make a difference, is to help unpack and identify what types of policies actually matter most. Right? So it's not particularly useful to say we need to improve economic governance, except, of course, that it's really fundamental, so that is something you need to do. But within particular service sectors, what's the relationship between some of the discriminatory barriers we're seeing that is picked up by the indices that we have on services trade restrictiveness and kind of regulatory measures that apply domestically? I think that is really an area where there is a fair amount of work to be done. I think where there also needs to be a lot more work is to try and identify which sectors actually matter most. So if we're thinking about value chains, whether they're agricultural, whether they're manufacturing, I think we need to, in terms of policy diagnosis and in terms of trying to identify where we should put our marginal aid for trade resources, that really should be much more informed by an analysis which looks at what are the specific sectors that actually matter for these value chains and where is policy actually increasing cost in a way that is not needed, or where is there no policy where we need policy in order to actually ensure that these things work more efficiently and that there is more competition in a network and so forth. So I think that's really the area for research that I see great need for, and I very much hope that you guys in ODI are going to be doing that.
Thank you very much, Bernard. So you first started out challenging us on the ideas on economic transformation, that it's not just about industrialization, and even if it is about industrialization, that services have a major input into making sure that industrialization happens, and that the two sectors are very much interlinked, and that the efficiency of services are very much important for exporting. And in that sense, and I think that's also something that Max highlighted, and what we found is that those countries that have been able to transform economically, that have been able to raise productivity over a sustained period of time, so labor productivity, have done that by both increasing the productivity contribution from manufacturing and from services as well. So it's a story of balanced growth, really, which is coming back. Okay, we now turn to Arantxa Gonzalez for your contribution. Over to you.
Thank you very much. Actually, Bernard stole my thunder because my starting point was going to be I have banned two words from my vocabulary. One is industrialization, the other one is exports. Industrialization is economic transformation, and exports is trade today. And actually, if we want to get a bit more accurate, it's not just trade, it's internationalization, which is putting trade together with investment. So thank you for making my task easier there. I think we are discussing here two elements. One is in this process of economic transformation, which is, I agree, about increasing the productivity of your factors of production at home. There is two elements that we, and if we are to link this to trade, there is two elements we need to think about. One is how to make trade possible. The other one is how to make trade happen. Because it is not because you make trade possible that trade is going to happen. Bit obvious, but we would do good in remembering this. In making trade possible, what I have missed, Dirk, in your analysis of economic transformation is how more than 98% of the economic tissue of any country fits into this economic transformation. This is called small and medium enterprises. What we know is that they are less productive. If you look at small and medium enterprises, they are less productive than big firms, and therefore they pay lower wages. So a big task is narrowing the productivity gap of small and medium enterprises. And why should we care about this? It's because they, through this narrowing of the productivity gap, they can contribute more to the growth of the economy, to GDP growth, but also because through that they can contribute more to higher wages and to a more inclusive growth, which is also part of the economic transformation story. Now, in our own research in the International Trade Center, we find a correlation between internationalization of SMEs and increasing the productivity of the SMEs. And again, it's internationalization is not just exports. It's exports and imports and outward and inward investment internationalization. And so what we see is the firms that internationalize, the SMEs that internationalize, are more productive and pay higher wages. Now, we can work it the other way around, as Bernard said, but, you know, at the end of the day, it leads to the same, it points in the same direction. Now, in this, so when we think of making trade possible, we need to promote robust public-private dialogues so that the making trade possible is influenced also, internalizes the needs, the demands that this SME world bring with them. There is, in my view, a big regional dimension in this internationalization of SMEs, regional integration, because the first test of the internationalization is very often going to be with the most immediate context, which is the region. So there is also a relationship, therefore, between increasing the productivity, supporting SME internationalization, and promoting regional integration. Now, this is what has driven us to put together this grid of 38 criteria to look at what drives SME internationalization, looking at the big macro business environment, looking at the most close business environment to the SME, and then looking at the SME in itself, which we have then categorized in the ability of the SME to connect, the ability of the SME to compete, and the ability of the SME to change. It's a bit the story that we unpacked in a similar session we had here yesterday together with you. So that gives us a sense of how to craft a regulatory context, the policies, the laws, the regulations that are going to foster SME competitiveness. But this is only half of the story. Now the other half, making trade happen. how do we support this to become a reality for the small and medium enterprises. For us, it's a matter of five elements. Number one is about trade and market intelligence. It's supporting the SME. It's not because the good business environment is there that they are going to internationalize. There is a need to dive a bit more for the SME to dive into where the economic opportunities are for this internationalization. So for us, number one is trade and market intelligence. Number two is about the nuts and bolts of the competitiveness of the enterprise, is about improving the quality of the product, is about innovating on the product or the service, is about packaging, is about labeling, is about marketing. I mean, it's a host of criteria that one needs to work on in order to have a product or a service that the market to which you want to go is ready and is interested in. Three is about trade and investment institutions. We sometimes forget that the jump between the SME and the international market is going to be intermediated by a trade or investment institution. Is the Chamber of Commerce, is the Trade Promotion Organization, is the Association of Women. A big part of these SMEs are women-owned SMEs. Fourth element is about access to credit. It's essential to support the internationalization of the companies. I would say it's essential to move from the informal to the formal sector, from the micro to the small, and from the small to the medium. But, and final is about connecting the SMEs to the market. All of the above is very interesting, but in the end, what matters is whether or not the SME transacts a business. Now, in this connecting to the market, there is a, and this is where we go back to making trade possible, there is a big market called e-commerce. And this is where I want to link this also with the services. This big e-commerce market suffers not only from hardware limitations, not only from connectivity, but it also suffers from regulatory frameworks on logistics, on distribution, and more importantly, on finance that are not allowing the small and medium enterprises to use e-commerce as the vehicle through which to internationalize. And if you want a big, bit of an appetizer on that, we've put together an analysis of e-commerce in Africa, looking at analyzing companies, small and medium enterprises, and looking at e-commerce platforms in Africa, and you have extremely interesting data which would guide policymakers into what to fix to make this ecosystem of e-commerce a bit more active. So supporting the calls to better, to work on better regulating services, which are, again, an enabler for greater value addition, for greater productivity, whether it's in manufacturing or whether it's in agriculture, which today, frankly, it's called agro-processing, or whether it's in exporting or trading in services proper. So that's, Dirk, what I would put on the table.
Well, thank you, Arantxa. And I think you sort of contributed to this idea about thinking more about the fact that ideas matter. It's that we need to balance our ideas on what economic transformation is. It's not just industrialization. It's also moving productivity across the range of sectors. It's important to think about balancing our views on how that can be done, the links between ideas on what economic transformation is. It's not just industrialization, it's also moving productivity across the manufacturing and services sector, in the last point about e-commerce, for example. And also highlighting in particular the issue of size in this debate, so because large firms might be the ones that are more transformational. And sometimes the ideas are there that small firms don't contribute that much, or an if the firm. And so there is sort of one strand of thought that is thinking about dealing with large firms in economic transformation. They are low productivity, that you then can't actually adjust them upwards, and that there's not much potential to move them up to high productivity firms. But I think what you say is that there's a range of factors that you can think about of how to internationalize SMEs and so that they can also contribute to productivity change and economic transformation. Thank you very much. So we now move to Frank Matzard for your comments.
Thanks very much, Dirk. And I must say, I feel privileged to be on such a high-level panel, so many thanks. It's always great coming last because, you know, most people have said what's really pertinent already, but let me see if there are any particular points that might add value here. I think, Dirk and Arantxa, you mentioned really about market size, and I think particularly, I'm based here in East Africa, I head up, and that regional market size is a very important issue. Generally, LDC markets are small and fragmented. To reap economies of scale and to give opportunities, you need to think regionally. So I think, you know, that's one thing, Max, that I think, you know, really trying to integrate markets with goods across borders, it really doesn't mean anything to anybody. So to me, you know, that's really important. As opposed to de jure in law. Secondly, and I think services play a key role. I was recently at the East African Manufacturing Summit in Kampala, where I think 45% of the value of garments and textile exports accounted for by transport and logistics. And, you know, I think that, you know, you use the phrase around your nuts and bolts. I mean, logistics is the nuts and bolts of trade. It's how goods move around. And those services, you know, as Bernard said, are critical to the competitiveness. And we've got to think about services as an enabler of competitiveness. And to me, logistics is something that my organization, Trademark, we're going to really be focusing on in the next 5 years, because, so, you know, logistics and transport services are very inefficient. The costs are very high, and let's face it, there are a lot of cartels. But, you know, to help services trade happen, we also need to make sure that the trade environment for allowing services to move is there. And I had the benefit of talking to Richard Newfarmer this morning, and, you know, let's look at East Africa. I mean, Tanzania, huge barriers to trade and services. I think, you know, people often talked really about the Tanzanian economy sometimes being starved of human capital in terms of being able to import services competitively. We need to look at services trade and we need to liberalize. And we've been doing some work trying to help professional services move across borders, but there is a lot of protectionism. And this is something that's very important. And, you know, I think we've all observed that our economies, particularly LDC economies, need to move from, you know, lower productivity to higher productivity, and services is a key way of doing that. If you can't liberalize services, then that won't happen. So it's really important. Okay, and I think really the last point that I wanted to make as well is that, you know, services cover such a broad variety of different areas. And, you know, certainly in terms of trade facilitation, they play a very important role. And I just really wanted to kind of, I guess, reflect that, you know, we often talk about an infrastructure gap that's there, that, you know, infrastructure is a key problem. But actually, when you look at it, it's often the use of that infrastructure and the way that services align with that I think also have an important impact. So these things are very related, and I think that the importance of services is critical. And as Arantxa said, you know, really access to trade intelligence to make those services happen and move across is also incredibly important. So I think all of the things said today are important ingredients in economic transformation. And the challenge for us is, particularly in Africa, is to move to a much higher value and higher productivity environment. We've seen great progress on reducing trade costs, but we need to see a production response. And this is a very, very important agenda for the future of Africa. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Frank, highlighting the importance of the regional markets in this debate, pointing out also the importance of logistics services for productivity down the line. I think that's something we've done also recently at ODI, some work connecting the importance of regional infrastructure with indirect effects of regional infrastructure, so the productivity effects that might have. And it's not just about hard infrastructure, but it's also about soft infrastructure, and it's combining those elements. And I think that's very important to take that into account in logistics services. So there are a number of issues that have been put on the table today. We believe that trade is important for economic transformation, but there are some issues about is there enough emphasis on a balanced view of this? So should we rebalance some of the debate towards services, or have we focused too much on services and not much on the linkages between services and manufacturing? We've highlighted the debates around market size. Is market size important? And about size of firms, is that important? And with all this, ideas matter and also implementation matter. And there's a lot of things that Arantxa, for example, is highlighting that needs to be done. There's lots of nitty-gritty work that needs to be done in order to make trade and economic transformation happen. So you've been very patient listening to all of us, six speakers, in fact. And now it's a chance for you to make points or ask any questions to the panelists. Maybe you could sort of introduce yourself briefly, who you are, and then make your points that you'd like to make. Who would like to go first? That's the lady at the back.
Hi, Jodie Keane from the Commonwealth Secretariat. Great presentation, Max. Really enjoyed it. I just wanted to pick up on the last point that Bernard made with regards to competition and targeting in value chains and thinking about aid for trade. And I think that is a really, really important point, particularly considering this aspect of competition. And the reason why it's so important is because the more qualitative global value chain literature does draw attention to changes in governance structures. And this, these changes in value chain governance structures and the kind of tiers of global suppliers that have evolved, it does mean that some upgrading routes that have in the past, you know, been a driver of upgrading a form of structural economic transformation, that they're no longer available. So given that context, I wanted to ask why you haven't looked at manufacturing. And, you know, so if you could just give some reasons as to why you have not looked at manufacturing. You've given lots of reasons as to why you've looked at services, but not why you haven't looked at manufacturing. And then I also wanted to just prompt you a little bit further, Max, with your result regarding the high degree of firm-level heterogeneity in your sample. And I wanted you just, yeah, if you could just explain that result a bit more, because you said it's higher for developing countries, and is that's compared to developed? Is it over time or what? Because that literature is linked to, you know, considering tiers of global suppliers, we know that literature suggests that these firms, the most productive firms in a given sector, are more likely to be foreign owned and integrated within these sorts of production networks. And finally, I just to conclude, it's really important to consider this project within a broader framework of global value chain governance, because then you start drawing in the aspects related to competition and also related to, you know, public and private investments. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Jodie. Is there anybody else who'd like to make the point out? Yeah, over to you.
I'm Chris Schrage from the University of Northern Iowa and in the U.S. And what I'm wondering is, we know that a lot of the SMEs in the developing countries, lesser developing countries, are not necessarily opportunistic entrepreneurs, but more survival entrepreneurs. And has that aspect been considered when we look at the percentages of those who go into trade? I mean, they're only doing business because they have to survive. Are they really excited about the aspect of trade?
The gentleman at the back.
Hi, good morning. My name is William Davis. I work for United Nations Economic Commission for Africa. I had two comments based on the presentations by the panelists. The first one relates to the presentation by Chris Barton. It's about his comment regarding the role of trade and development. And, I think we all recognize the potential for trade to support economic transformation. At the same time, it's, as many present here will have seen from our latest edition of our flagship report, Economic Report in Africa, ECA is nonetheless still calling for infant industry protection. And why are we doing that? If we were going to follow neoclassical economic theory, infant industry protection wouldn't be necessary because if an infant industry had potential to be competitive, then sufficient capital would flow in to build up the industry to the extent that was needed, and it would then become competitive, and that kind of trade protection wouldn't be required. However, for a variety of reasons, I guess we may not really expect that to happen, either because of barriers to foreign investment, simply lack of knowledge through investors or other financial market reforms that need to take place. I think this is probably one of the key reasons why the report identifies this. At the same time, we know that the import substitution industrialization project failed to deliver. What do we need to do differently so that infant industry protection doesn't kind of remain permanent and just, preserve industries that continue to have a low level of productivity and are not going to become competitive? The results of some of the other work that we've done suggest that there are a number of key elements. The first is dynamic industrial policy that is based on dialogue with the private sector. A second one is highly selective trade policy that is linked to industrial policies and has measures, for example, such as low tariffs on the inputs needed for the strategic sectors that are being targeted. And the third one is support measures for those strategic sectors that are made contingent on increasing competitiveness within those sectors. You can't just give an open-ended guarantee of support. It needs to be contingent on the sectors increasing their productivity. That's the first comment. Sorry I'm taking so long. Second comment is about Professor Hoekman's remarks on further research for trade and services. And it's also an area where we've been doing some work. And I just wanted to reflect that, the World Bank Services Trade Restrictions database is a fantastic database with all of the kinds of granular policy variables that we would need to examine to see, exactly which measures make the difference in terms of service sector competitiveness and so on. The problem is that there aren't enough data points to do proper econometric analysis. I know because I've tried, and that the data matrix is simply underdetermined. And as I understand it, the World Bank has said that that database was a one-off exercise. They're not going to recollect data every year. They just wanted to show what could be done. But they weren't going to continue collecting. So I think somebody needs to pick up the baton, and carry on that database so that we have enough data points to do the kind of research that that you're suggesting. Thank you very
much. Thank you very much. Nick. Yeah, Nick. Yeah.
Sorry. Thank you very much. Nick Charalambides, Imani Development. I just thought to make a comment on actually some work we did with ODI way back when, Doug, on Rwanda, which again I think highlighted the link between your trade in goods and the development of your services. And I think one of the clearest examples we came across in the region, and where the region really matters, was on the growth of telecommunications. You know, the EAC common external tariff was punishing any new entrant into the market by taxing the capital, taxing the networks when they wanted to invest and bring in their work. Now, at the moment, this is being dealt with by exemption. And so we still have these one-offs. And I think sort of you were looking at the region, and sort of we can't lose track of the tariffs, the common external tariffs in the link. We're catching services into trade in goods, but I think we sometimes miss the need for maybe adopting a reference paper at the regional level. Kenya has suggested this, a reference paper in telecommunications. I think we could be more active in linking our trade in goods and the CET with our services growth and get a virtuous cycle. And that was work we did together, Doug.
Thanks, Nick. Thanks. I think Richard has his hand up for a long time, and then I'd like to go back to the panel, and then after that there will be more time to ask questions.
Thanks. This is maybe a little academic, but just a comment on Max's paper and all of the research which is looking at the structural transformation itself. I've been a little puzzled by a couple of things. First of all, in your analysis, I wondered if you, among the ways that trade affects productivity in goods, we've seen the studies of Mark Mundler in Brazil and, I don't know, Jim Tyback way back on Chile. And one of the things that seems to be happening, actually this is true also in the Learning to Compete study of John Page, that when economies are exposed to trade in the manufacturing sector, what you see is a narrowing of dispersion around average productivity, because the competitive fringe that may be protected by a high inefficient price level is competed out, right? And so sometimes, by the way, these are SMEs, but the average productivity goes up because of competition. So that might be part of the story that maybe deserves a little more emphasis than what you've given it here. But the second interesting part is the Roderick puzzle, the Macmillan puzzle. You know, why is it you see in the aggregate number movement of labor from high productivity sectors, namely manufacturing, into low productivity sectors, namely services? Right? And I think what could be going on here is, in fact, it's low productivity workers moving out of manufacturing into high productivity firms in services. Thinking about this at the firm level, I think, would clarify a little bit of that. And there's a second dimension here that I think is worth looking at. It came out in some of Patrick Lowe's comments on our panel on Tuesday, which is that there is an increasing element of outsourcing of services from manufacturing firms. And indeed, it goes to Dirk's point. As the market gets bigger, it can support specialization in legal services, for example, in architectural and engineering services that can serve many manufacturing firms. And so it's no longer important to have those services embedded in the company. Rather, you can outsource them, so sort of following costs, you know, outsourcing these yields, economies of scales and service production. So I think we might want to focus on that. And the final element of the story of interpreting low productivity in services is the whole problem of urbanization. You know, you have massive movements, particularly in Africa, at an early stage of development of people from low productivity agriculture into actually low productivity service jobs. You know, you find people selling MTN cards on the sidewalk. You know, this is very low productivity stuff. So in services, I'd expect a different phenomena occurring in terms of that dispersion of productivity around the mean among firms, and especially when you include informal labor. Sorry, but I think there's some things going on here that ought to be examined.
Very good. That's already been a rich debate and a rich set of comments. And I'd like to sort of turn to the panel, and maybe I'll start with Max, but as everybody could focus on a few points, maybe not all of them, and limit it to sort of 2 to 3 minutes, that would be great, and then we can then go back to the panel. I think there are some issues about firm level or heterogeneity in terms of productivity that is coming back. There are some issues about infant industry protection, I think, that need to be discussed as well.
Okay. To address Jody's point on why we have not focused on manufacturing, well, I mean, it's not that we are downplaying the role of manufacturing in economic transformation. It's far from that. But basically, we want, in a way, trying to break a big link between what is industrialization and economic transformation. And also, we highlight, and also was mentioned, the increasing productivity in agriculture and also the agro-processing, and I agree that that is an issue I mentioned, as another routes that you can follow in terms of economic transformation. So I think why no suggesting focus on economic, on manufacturing is because there are other routes, and also if you want, I mean, we want to avoid a sort of congestion of everybody going into manufacturing at the same time. So basically having alternatives and providing alternatives in economic transformation is important. In terms of the heterogeneity of firms, probably I can answer Judith and Richard's point at the same time, is basically one of the things that we found is that, as is mentioned, in developing countries, the variance of productivity within firms, within sectors in firms, tend to be bigger. I mean, you have high productivity firms, and at the same time, you have very low productivity firms. Whilst in developed countries, that tend to be that dispersion, that variance, tend to be smaller. And this is something associated with a within sector productivity change. So one of the ways of economic transformation is jumping into more productive firms. The other way, as you mentioned, is precisely make those firms actually try to reduce the dispersion within the sector. So I think that is a channel that is definitely considered. That the evidence is not present here that we had found is that actually there are some exceptions. It was the structural change when you decompose the productivity change between what is within sector and between sector was the between sector productivity change, the one that have dominated in the last few years. I will pass the mic to others.
Yeah. Okay. I suppose this issue about heterogeneity is also between sectors, actually, in the sense that at low income levels there are just heterogeneity across all levels. It's across locations within a country. It's across firms within a sector. It's across productivity across sectors. There are just gaps, and that gives us a huge potential for productivity increases all around through trade and through other means. So I think we agree. Arantxa. Over to you.
Very shortly on the survival entrepreneurs versus professional entrepreneurs, so to speak, to cut a long story short and to use a bit of a colloquial language. It's true that there is a lot of survival entrepreneurs, which I would call informal sector. It's huge. Now, we have to ask ourselves the question of whether this is because of the entrepreneur or this is because of the environment in which the entrepreneur is operating. I mean, in my view, there is a large informal sector, three reasons. Low skills, red tape, taxation systems. You see a correlation between these three elements and the bulge in the informal sector. Two, there is a natural, I mean, it's part of entrepreneurship, risk-taking. You see a lot of them that would test and try, not work, go and do something else. So in my view, the problem is not this distinction between survival entrepreneurs and professional entrepreneurs, but what ecosystem we give the entrepreneurs who want to move from the informal to the formal, from the micro to the small, and from the small to the medium. Short comment on infant industry protection. I have lots of questions for you. Do you do this infant industry protection per country or per region? Because I think we've agreed in the previous discussion that we want to create larger markets. Infant industry protection may make sense in Nigeria. I'm asking myself the question is if it would make sense to do this in Rwanda or in Burundi. So, is it national or is it regional? Two, is it going to be conducive to the emergence of value chains if we do infant industry protection? Is it really that the investor would go to the country because there is a set of trade rules that protect against imports of a certain product? Or should we, and this would be maybe my suggestion, is let's not have trade drive the business ecosystem. Let's make sure we work on infrastructure, rule of law, good business environment, and let's make sure that the trade policy is conducive to this. Otherwise, we would have a tail wagging a dog, in my view. But I mean, again, I have more questions than I have answers at the moment.
Bernard?
On Jody's question, I think it's important. I don't know if it's part of this project or not, but I think there is clearly an issue in terms of what you'd call about the governance of the value chains, which is ultimately it goes back to traditional questions of market conduct, structure, competition. So I think these competition issues are important, and we certainly seem to be seeing them in this region. You know, Mark mentioned on the transport side, that will be an example. So I think the value chain type of focus kind of helps identify why this actually is even more of a problem than it otherwise would be, because it really prevents this type of specialization and the gains from trade that were mentioned earlier in this panel. And we're really not focusing on that, I think, anywhere near enough, if we are at all. So I think this is something that is important. And I think part of the literature you're talking about, the more qualitative literature, tends to focus on these lead firms and the behavior of the lead firms. Whereas, in fact, I think what is much more problematical is what happens inside the value chain, and in particular, kind of at the upstream end of the chain. But ultimately, you know, it all boils down to, as well as, do these lead firms have market power? Are they competing in the end markets? That is also an important question. On the survival question, I think there's a huge amount of literature on this, that, you know, it's really the high growth, the new firms, the more dynamic firms, that matter the most in terms of employment creation, and those are the ones who ultimately are the ones who are going to grow into large firms. So from an industrial policy point of view, you really want to focus on that segment of the firms. But I think I'll be a bit less polite than Arantxa. I think putting this in the notion of infant industry protection is the best thing you can do to kill the idea, because that's just, I don't know, I thought that was dead, and it should be. So I think it really is an issue of being very clear as to what is the market failure, what are we trying to fix here. Otherwise, you know, we're back to the past. And I'm a bit struck by a lot of the discussions in terms of trying to promote manufacturing that is going around, not just in this part of the world. I mean, we have the same thing in Europe, we have the same thing in the US, where somehow politicians have got it in their heads that it's actually good to have factories, blue-collar workers, assembling stuff, which is not where we are anymore, right? So I think that really is something to, I don't know, that's the point I wanted to make. And using trade policy, I think, is absolutely the worst thing you can do, right? Because ultimately what you're doing is you're cutting yourself off from the value chain. You're going to break down the regional integration that is needed to make these markets bigger. So I think that is something I would very much question, if that is the central plank of what the UNECA is trying to do. So not to say that we don't have market failures, not to say that we don't need government support for particular activities, but I think we need to be very clear as to what those are. And I would argue that all the evidence and all the research that has been presented here and has been discussed in terms of the importance of trade costs, the importance of trade barriers actually as an inhibitor to doing more in terms of developing new higher value added activities, all point to, and I'll echo Arantxa, in terms of focus on those issues. And also, I would say focus more on getting a neutral incentive framework in place, right? So agriculture is a huge sector for Africa. There's huge potential to increase the productivity of agriculture. But agriculture is also the sector in Africa that gets taxed, right? So it's the only region in the world where we still have net agricultural protection. So in a sense, we're actually putting additional burden on activities that where you actually have a comparative advantage, where I think that should also be part of this consideration as to where do you put policy focus. On the STRI, yes. So currently there's just a cross-section. We only have one data point. The World Bank, as I understand it, has come to an agreement with the WTO. So the WTO is going to be actually doing a lot of the updating of the STRI database. Hopefully over time we're going to get more data that actually allows us to construct a panel and therefore do more of a time series type of an analysis.
Thanks. Frank. I think much of it's been said. I mean, on competition, I think competition policy plays a really important role in the efficiency of a lot of services value chain. And certainly you said about transport, it's something that we're at the moment looking at with the East African community, because there's quite a concentration Arantxa said, you know, a lot about the informal sector. I mean, let's face it, most of our economies here are very much dominated by the informal sector. It's a key dynamo of employment. And I'd add to what she said, really, to say we have problems with dual labor markets. And I think there's a real problem with the way that labor regulation operates. It creates a very expensive formal sector, and then it has, you know, really the have-nots in the informal sector. And I think that's quite a big problem. And the reality is actually as well that employers get around over-regulation through poor employment conditions, even in the formal sector as well. So, you know, it's important to reflect on all that when you think about services, I guess. Nick, very nice to see you. I agree with you completely about telecoms. And I think one of the really exciting things that's happened is what's happening on the Northern Corridor Initiative, where the barriers to telecoms have just been brought down, roaming charges gone. I don't think we have that in Europe. Fantastic. It's really, really, really been good for telecoms. And telecoms have driven massive growth in Africa. So very important sector, actually. And, you know, it enables, as you said, Arantxa, it enables, you know, money transfer. Financial services are now being delivered through mobile phones. I can go here in Kenya and pay for anything with M-Pesa. So it's really, you know, it's an important enabler. A lot's been said about your industry point, sir. I'm not a great believer in it. And in the end, is it the consumer that suffers? I'll just ask you that question. But the most important thing is to drive competitiveness, which is what we've been talking about, mm-hmm. productivity, competitiveness. And, you know, those drivers, you know, are the most important thing. And the question as well is, if you have an infant industry protection approach, is how do you phase it out? I think that's been the problem in Africa a lot, and all over the world. It's just stayed there, and the consumer is the one that really suffers.
Well, thank you very much indeed. While the panel was speaking, I got the hand of 5 minutes left, and I think that's almost now gone. So I'm afraid that that I can't give the floor now to the rest of the panel. I suppose the and the rest of the audience, I think we've discussed a range of important issues here, and we may want to discuss that further informally afterwards. I think what is overall important is to focus on having balanced ideas around this debate on economic transformation, and do not think about that you can do it only through manufacturing or only through services. It's a balanced view thinking about this. It's thinking about a balanced view of the range of firm size that is important. Think about using regional as well as the international markets. And I think that those are sort of important debates that will carry through. And just on the infant industry protection argument, I think it does still resonate in a range of countries, and I think that is probably a way of looking into the literature that may not be completely correct, and it's and also, but it does have some resonance, and I think it's important to deal with this in a proper way and through good evidence around this topic. And I think it's not just about building up services, it's also about manufacturing, and I think Jody left, but we're also working on manufacturing as well in other countries. So it is battling ideas, thinking about policies to implement this, that will remain very important. On that note, let me thank the panel for the presentations and the comments. Let me also thank the audience for all their questions and answers. And any point you want to make, you can fill out on the form that we collect, and you can also discuss it with us afterwards, and you can also look at it on our website. Thank you very much for being here. Hope to see you again.